Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update from Rouse IAS. Hello and welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading. Today we'll be taking up the Delhi edition of the Hindu newspaper dated 31st May 2021. Now the articles to be discussed are reflected on your screen and the time stamping has been provided in the description box below. So now let's begin.
Before we begin with the discussion, here is a very, very important announcement for you in case you are confused about which optional subject to choose, how to find the best teachers, and where is the right kind of academic support for your optional papers, and above all, how to actually prepare for the same during these very difficult and challenging times. Then let me tell you that Rouse IAS has the best solution for your optional subject related problems. And for this very reason, we are going to conduct 3 live online counseling sessions in which Vikram sir is going to talk about sociology, Indrajit sir is going to talk about geography, and Paramjeet sir is going to talk about history on 29th of May. These optional batches are starting from 4th of June 2021 via live online classes. Now consider this as a call to all those who wish to completely cover the optional subject by December 2021. Now this will ensure timely coverage of optional subject and then you can focus your attention completely on prelims from January or February 2022. Now as you all know that Rouse IAS is offering guidance for political science, public administrations, history, sociology, geography, economics and psychology from Delhi, Jaipur and Bangalore centers, and all these counseling sessions have already been taken by our faculties on 22nd of May. The video of the rest of the sessions conducted on the same day are available on Rouse eLearn platform. Sign in to your free eLearn account and watch these videos available under video series Optional Counseling 2021. Let us now begin the discussion.
Now this article appearing on the page number 8 of the Hindu newspaper talks about the death of Mithali Sivaraman, who is a chief CPIM leader, that is Communist Party of India, Maoist. Now the death of this veteran communist has brought to light the importance of the topic of communism from the point of view of the means of 2021. And hence in this article we shall take up a discussion on the left-wing extremism from the point of view of GS Paper 3, subsection Internal Security. Now let us start by first understanding what does one mean by communism. Now communism is basically an economic and a political ideology that on one hand opposes capitalism while on the other hand opposes democratic institutions or democracy in totality. Now this is because they believe that capitalism helps concentrate power, wealth and profit among a very small section of the population. And as a result of which, it is this section of the population that controls all the capital in the country and derives wealth through exploitation of the lower classes. And it is this political system of democracy, that is rule of the majority, that facilitates such exploitation. And as a result of which, communism despises both these systems. And hence it calls for a society that has no private property. All the resources are communally owned, that is all the resources are together owned by the society and each person receives a portion based on what they need. And thus this system calls for a transition from each according to its ability to each according to its need. That is in a capitalist system. We see that individuals are only able to get resources as per their hard work or their ability. However, communists are against this philosophy and they want all the individuals to get all the basic resources as per their need and not their ability. And hence this is one of the most important transition that communist society aims to make. And in order to do so, it calls for creation of a strong central government, wherein it is the state that controls all the aspects of economic production and provides all its citizens with the basic needs of food, clothing, security, medical care, education. And hence it is in this manner that the communists aim to ensure that all the individuals are able to get everything as per their need. And this is in short what communist philosophy aims to do. Now many of you are not really familiar with the ideology of communism, might believe that this system is one of an ideal system, for it ensures that all the citizens of the country are able to get resources as per their need. And if such a government is able to ensure all the needs are met, then there is nothing like it. However, this is not the case, given communism has lot of loopholes. Now let us try to see what are those. Now the first and the most important flaw in this system of communism is the means through which it advocates achievement of such a system. Now communism as a philosophy calls for a violent revolution of the worker class against the middle and the upper class. And it is through this violent revolution, it aims to overthrow the existing structure so as to bring about a communist system that eliminates all sort of private property, eliminates capitalism, democracy, and aims to ensure everybody is able to get everything according to their need. And thus a system that calls for violent revolution of one class of citizen against the another can never be considered as an ideal system. Now moving to the next challenge, that is with respect to poor economic performance. Now as we all know, the communist system calls for government to own all the business and property in terms of all the means of production. And hence by doing so, it removes all the competition that exists in the production system, giving rise to inefficiency, and as a result, the overall economic performance goes down. And this was witnessed in the hitherto USSR, that is the Soviet Union, that collapsed in 1991, even after it tried to overcome the problem of low economic performance by policies such as Perestroika and Glasnost, through which the then leader of the USSR tried to bring about openness and reform in its economy. However, as we all know, it failed and it led to eventual collapse of the USSR. Now moving on to the third challenge that is associated with the communist system. Now that is the problem of totalitarian and authoritarian state, as we see in the case of China. Now one of the key reasons behind this is the one party system that is in place in China that has resulted in oppression of the opposition, violence, human right violations, and in turn an authoritarian and a totalitarian state wherein its citizens do not enjoy the freedom that a citizen of a democratic country such as India enjoy. And hence this is one of the gravest challenge of a communist system. Now moving on to the last challenge, communism anywhere in the world has not been able to achieve its ideal state. That is a pure state of communist wherein there is no private property, all the resources are shared equally among the citizens. Now presently there are mainly 5 countries that practice communism in the world. Now these countries are North Korea, Cuba, Vietnam, Laos, and of course China. Now none of these 5 countries together with the earlier USSR have been able to achieve the ideal communist state. And hence this is considered as one of the greatest failure of the communism in the world. And hence recognizing all these factors, our great leaders in 1947 post our independence adopted capitalism as the economic system and parliamentary democracy as the political system of the country. Given all the key leaders of the country including the father of the nation was against any violent revolution and India had always followed the path of Satyagraha, that is truth and non-violence. Now communism as an idea was initially developed by 2 individuals, Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels. Now there's another variant of communism that is known as Maoism. Now this idea that was developed by Mao Zedong much later is mostly influenced by the ideas of the communism but is markedly different because it calls for different kind of societies. Now while communism mostly deals with industrial society wherein it calls for a violent revolution that calls the proletariat class to undertake a violent revolution against the bourgeois class that are the class of the business owners or the industrialist. Now, these are simple technical terms. You may not use these technical terms and you may stick to worker class and the upper class. Now, the proletariat form, the worker class, while the bourgeois is used to refer to the upper class. Now, the communism aims to bring about a revolution in an industrial society wherein the industrial workers are called for to unite and undertake a violent revolution against the bourgeois class. However, Mao Zedong invented Maoism to address the challenges of the agriculture society. Now, herein the agriculture workers or the landless class is called to unite to undertake a violent revolution against the landed class. And in India, it is this variant of communism, that is the Maoism, that developed under the name of Naxalism. Now, this name Naxalism was given because it originated through a violent revolution that undertook in the Naxalbari state of West Bengal and later spread to the eastern and the central India in terms of 9 states that form part of the Red Corridor. Now, this Naxalism is formally named as left-wing extremism in the country, which was discussed in detail on 3rd February 2021. Kindly refer to this DNS in case you have missed this pertinent discussion. Now, continuing with the topic of left-wing extremism or Naxalism in India, let us try to take a mains question discussion for this question that appeared in the UPSC examination in the year 2018. Now, this question reads, left-wing extremism is showing a downward trend but still affects many parts of the country. Briefly explain the Government of India's approach to counter the challenges posed by left-wing extremism. Now that we have basically understood the core of the topic of left-wing extremism, let us try to see how we can effectively write an answer to this question. Now, beginning with the introduction. Now, given this question is a statement-based question, wherein the statement suggests that left-wing extremism is showing a downward trend but still affects many parts of the country. So, in the introduction of the answer, we will begin with the elaboration of this given question statement. Now, herein the best way to address this question statement is to present data that justifies this downward trend but also justifies the fact that left-wing extremism is still affecting various parts of the country. But before that, you need to define what does one mean by left-wing extremism in a short and a precise manner. Now, as we had studied, left-wing extremism basically refers to anti-government insurgency that aims to overthrow the government through means of a violent revolution. Now, India as the country has been facing this onslaught since more than 50 years now. Now, this began during the Naxalbari incident, wherein in 1967, peasants of the Naxalbari village rose against the exploitation of the land-owning class. And it was since then India saw the onslaught of the left-wing extremism or the problem of Naxalism. However, in the recent years, because of the efforts of Government of India, there has been some downward trend that has been witnessed with respect to left-wing activity in the country. Now, as per the data presented by the Union Minister of State in Rajya Sabha, suggests that there has been as much as 47% decline in left-wing extremism-related activities between the last 5 years vis-a-vis the previous 5 years. That is, the left-wing extreme activities that were witnessed in the year 2009-14, that is, these 5 years, have seen a 50% decline in next 5 years, that is, between 2015-20. And this is a huge success, given left-wing extremism has been named as one of the most serious security challenges that India has been facing. Further, it has been suggested even with respect to geographical spread, there has been a lot of improvement. Now, as per the data, in 2013, the left-wing extremism was spread to as much as 76 districts in 10 states of India. However, as per the recent data of the year 2020, this has been shrunk and has been reduced to merely 53 districts in 9 states. Now again, this is a huge achievement, and clearly there has been a significant decline with respect to the left-wing extremist activity in the country. However, as you can see, we are still not over with the issue of left-wing extremism, given still we have a lot of cases that keep occurring and reoccurring. Now, the casing point here is the recent incident that happened in the March of 2021, wherein a bus carrying security personnel was blown away, and as a result of which 5 of the security personnel were killed while 15 were injured. Now, as per a conservative estimate, it has been suggested that over the last 25 years, there have been at least 15,000 lives that have been lost in this Naxal violence. And hence, Government of India is trying its best to bring down further the issue of Naxalism in the country, and to a great extent, it has been successful. However, as we can see, there are still a lot of areas that are affected by the left-wing extremism, and there are also a lot of left-wing extremism related incidents that are occurring, a prime example of which is the one recently witnessed by the country. And hence, let us look into what are the approaches that Government of India has been undertaken over the years to counter the challenges posed by the left-wing extremism. Now, moving on to the body part, herein we enlist the various approaches that the Government of India has been undertaken to counter the challenges posed by the left-wing extremism in the country. Now, beginning with the approaches, we list down 4 broad categories of approaches that Government of India has been undertaking. Now, first is with respect to administrative and governance related approach, wherein Government of India has been undertaking various initiatives that we'll see as we move forward. Second is approach with respect to social integration. Next is approaches with respect to law and order situation. And last, the approach that Government of India has undertaken with respect to rights of the tribals and land entitlement. Now, beginning with the first approach. Now, the first and the most important step that government has taken here is in 2006, when Government of India established a separate left-wing extremism division in the Ministry of Home Affairs. And this has been one of the most crucial steps that Government of India has been undertaken to effectively address the left-wing extremist insurgency in a holistic manner by allocating a separate division that looks and takes care of all the measures that are required to eradicate left-wing extremism from the India completely. Now, next, Government of India has introduced various governance related measures, such as it has introduced PESA Act, that is Panchayat Extension to Scheduled Areas Act in 1996. Now, this has been done so as to extend Panchayat related governance or the grassroots governance to all the 5th scheduled states. Now, this is because the 5th scheduled states are exempted from the provisions that are applicable under the 73rd Amendment to the Constitution. And hence, Panchayat Extension to Scheduled Areas Act was introduced so as to ensure greater autonomy by promotion of grassroots democracy in these areas. And as of now, in the total 108 PESA districts, as many as 42 districts are left-wing extremist districts. And hence, PESA has been working in 42 left-wing extremist districts so as to promote the governance in the grassroots areas of the left-wing extremist affected states. Now, moving on to the social integration aspect. Now, the Government of India has been undertaking a lot of infrastructure-related projects, wherein Government of India has been undertaking road connectivity projects and mobile tower projects so as to bring about adequate development of the state. Now, next, Government of India has been promoting education by establishing various Eklavya residential schools in the left-wing extremist states. Now, this is done to ensure that the literacy rate of the region goes up, alongside to ensure that youth of the region are able to gain gainful employment and do not fall under the traps of the left-wing extremist. Further, Government of India has been launching various schemes as a part of legislation. For example, Government of India has set up District Mineral Foundation as a part of Mines and Minerals Act. Now, this has been done so as to ensure all the mineral-rich districts, majority of which are part of the central and eastern India and fall under the left-wing extremist challenge, are able to gain from the mines and mineral activities that are undertaken in their region. As through this fund, all the mining districts are to receive a portion of the mining royalties. Now, this money is to be spent on development activities that are decided by the local people. And this is how Government of India has been trying to ensure social integration of the people living in the 9 states affected by the left-wing extremism. Now, moving on to the next approach, that is law and order approach. Now, here the first thing you need to remember is that police and public order are basically state subject. And the role of central government here is to help the state government by ensuring capacity building, supplementing their efforts, and by ensuring coordination among various states. And thus, in this regard, there has been one of the recent steps that was launched in 2017 under the name of Samadhan Doctrine. Now, this doctrine was extended by the national government so as to provide a national strategy to counter the left-wing extremist. Now, it aims to provide a multi-pronged approach so as to combat left-wing extremism alongside promoting participatory governance in the region. Now, moving towards the last approach, that is with respect to rights and entitlement. Now, as we all know, majority of the central and the eastern states are tribal states, and hence majority of the left-wing extremist states are mostly tribal in nature, and hence it is very important to ensure the rights of the tribal with respect to entitlement of forest and with respect to land entitlement is respected. And hence, in this regard, the Government of India has introduced the Forest Right Act of 2006. Now, this act is aimed to ensure that the scheduled tribes and other traditional forest dwellers get their rights with respect to forests recognized under this act. Further, the Government of India has also introduced the Land Acquisition Act of 2013. Now, this act was introduced so as to give a legal backing to the previously existing National Rehabilitation and Resettlement Policy of 2007 with the aim to minimize the displacement of people and to promote least displacing alternatives. Now, this was done so as to counter the approaches that over the years have led to displacement of thousands of tribal dwellers. And hence, both these policies were aimed to overcome the concerns of the tribal dwellers with respect to their rights of the forest and rights of the land. And hence, all these 4 approaches have been undertaken by the Government of India successfully to counter the challenges posed by the left-wing extremists. Now, moving on to the conclusion part, we'll address why is the country, even after all these approaches, still continuing to face the challenge of left-wing extremism in certain parts of the country. While overall there has been a downtrend, but still, as we know, there are certain parts that continue to remain affected, and there has to be a reason why this tendency is happening even after Government of India has been undertaking various countering approaches in the past decades. So now the first and the most important reason here is that the steps that Government of India has been undertaken are not implemented effectively. And one of the most important example here is that of PESA Act. Very few governments have actually taken proper implementation of the PESA Act, and as a result of which PESA has been failed to deliver what it was mandated. Now, moving on to the second reason behind failure of these steps is that there is lack of proper and accurate intelligence, because of which the law and order effort of the government is being negatively affected. Now, it has been suggested that presently the human intelligence remains one of the most important sources of intelligence for the law and order implementers of the region. However, human intelligence, as we all understand, has lot of issues and is unreliable and sometimes even misleading. And as a result of which, it is important for Government of India to undertake technological solutions in terms of use of UAVs, etc., so as to ensure it has actual tactical intelligence that is accurate and to the point. Now, next important challenge is in terms of conflict with respect to development process. Now, as we had studied, while on the one hand, Government of India has been creating District Mineral Foundation so as to ensure the tribal areas are able to gain from the royalties generated because of the mining activities. The case of the Vedanta in the Nyamgiri Hills reflects opposite, wherein the tribal people have been opposing the mining by Vedanta in the Nyamgiri Hills by tooth and nail. Similar is the case with respect to Narmada Sagar project, wherein the tribals along with the civil society have been opposing the development project that Government of India has been undertaking. And hence there has been some loopholes with respect to the understanding that Government of India has with respect to development process of the tribal areas vis-a-vis the demand of the tribals themselves. And hence, as the concluding line, we would suggest that while India has made some success in containing the Naxalism, but the root cause have not been addressed. Now, root cause, as we all understand, is poor development, lack of employment opportunities, poor governance, etc. And these issues, even after the approaches that government has undertaken, still continue to remain unaddressed. Further, even the steps that government have undertaken are fraught with challenges. And hence, there is a need for government to ensure a collaborative approach with the tribals of the region, wherein the tribal communities are brought in with respect to participative development of the overall tribal region that forms a majority of the left-wing extremist states. And it is only through participatory development that we can address the overall challenges posed by the Naxalism in the country. And with this, we complete the discussion of this question. I would encourage you to write an answer based on the discussion, and I would try to assess few of the answers as presented in the comment box below. Now, moving on to the next article. Now, this article appearing on the page number 10 of the Hindu newspaper has been titled as Commando Training, More Firepower for the Kaziranga National Park Guards. Now, these steps have been undertaken so as to prevent any poaching of the one horned rhino that is a vulnerable species and is found in abundance in the Kaziranga National Park of Assam. Now, given the massive importance of this topic, it appeared in the 2019 UPSC prelim examination, wherein the UPSC framed one of the options as one horned rhino is naturally found only in India. Now, by the end of the discussion, we'll come back to this question and see if this statement was correct or incorrect. Now, there are three species of rhinos that are available in Asia, namely Great One Horned Rhino, Javan Rhino and Sumatran Rhino. But out of the three categories, there is only one category of rhino that is found in India, that is the Great One Horned Rhino. Now, this is also known as the Indian rhino, and it is the largest of the three species of rhino. Now, poaching and habitat loss has by far been the two of the greatest threat with respect to survival of the Asia's rhinos. And thus, in this regard, the New Delhi Declaration of Asian Rhinos 2019 was launched that aimed to cover the five rhino range nations that include India, Bhutan, Nepal, Indonesia and Malaysia. Now, a key point to note here is the protection status of different species. Now, both Javan and Sumatra rhino are critically endangered, while the Indian rhino or the great one-horned rhino is a vulnerable species. Please make a note of this. Further, it has been listed under the Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act. Now, moving on to the habitat of the great one rhino. Now, the habitat of this rhino is mainly restricted to a small area along the Indo-Nepal Terai region. Further, it is also found in the western Bengal and Assam region. Now, let us try to locate all the wildlife sanctuaries and national parks that have one-horned rhino on this map. Now, the first is the Manas Wildlife Sanctuary, second is the Orang Wildlife Sanctuary, and the third is, of course, the Kaziranga National Park. Now, in the recent time, the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change has begun a project that aims to create a DNA profile of all the rhinos in the country. Further, government has also introduced in 2019 the National Rhino Conservation Strategy to conserve the Great One-Horned Rhino or the Indian Rhino. Further, government has also introduced the Indian Rhino Vision of 2020, that is a partnership among the government of Assam, International Rhino Foundation, World Wildlife Fund for Nature, Bodoland Territorial Council, and the US Fish and World Wildlife Forum. And this vision was designed in 2005 so as to attain a population of 3,000 wild one-horned rhino in the 7 protected areas of Assam by the year 2020. Now, as we have discussed, by far the rhinos are available in 3 national park and wildlife sanctuary, that is Kaziranga, Orang and Povidora. Further, it aims to ensure that these rhinos are spread to other 4 protected areas, that is Manas, Lau Khao and Buracha Pori Kochmora and Dibrusa Sirkhau. Now, moving back to the 2019 prelims question. Taking up the third statement, that is one-horned rhino is naturally found in India only. Now, clearly this is incorrect because we had just studied that these are found in the Indo-Nepal Terai region, and hence it is clear that it is not just found in India. Further, the great one-horned rhino is also found in Bhutan, Pakistan, along with Nepal and India. Thus, this statement is incorrect. Further, with respect to the first statement, Asiatic lion is naturally found in India only. This is a correct statement. Now, the second statement is double hump camel is naturally found in India only. Now, again, this statement is incorrect. Although we have not taken discussion of these two topics, but I would request you to Google out some information about the habitat of the Asiatic lion and the geographical region they are found in. Similarly, please try to research a bit about double humped camel. The correct answer for this is A1 only. Now, this article appearing on the widget of the page number 5 of the Hindu newspaper has been titled as Sri Padmabhaswami Temple Elephant Dies. Now, this elephant was gifted by the erstwhile Travancore king to the famed Padmabhaswami temple. Now, this temple is one of the most important and famous temples of India and is located in the capital of the Kerala states, that is Thiruvananthapuram. Now, this temple, as per the historians, dates back to the 8th century. However, the present structure has been built in the 18th century by the then Travancore Maharaja. Now, this temple is built in the unique Chera style of architecture, and its main deity is Lord Vishnu, that is found in Anantashaya position, that is reclined posture of eternal yoga. That is, Lord Vishnu is sitting in a reclined position on the Adishesha, that is king of all serpents. Further, this is known as one of the 108 holy temples that are associated with the Vaishnavism in India. And it is not only one of these 108, it is also one of the most important of all these temples. And since independence, it has been controlled by a trust that is run by the royal family. Further, the deity of this temple represents the trinity of the Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva. And the last interesting point about this temple is that it has 365 pillars. Now, on various occasions, we have seen UPSC framing questions around temple. And there has been no question by far with respect to Padmabhas Swami temple. So please make note of the key points with respect to this temple, for it is likely to be asked in prelim examinations in the coming years. Now moving on to the next article. Now this article appearing on the page number 10 has been titled as "Accused Denied, Anticipatory Bail Can Be Given Protection." Now what does one mean by anticipatory bail? Now anticipatory bail basically means a pre-arrest bail that as per the CRPC or the Code of Criminal Procedure means that when a person has a reason to believe that he may be arrested on an accusation of having committed a non-bailable offence, he may apply to the High Court or Court of Session for a direction under this section. And if the court thinks fit, it may direct that in an event of an arrest, he shall be released on bail. That is, a person who has still not been arrested can apply for bail even before they are actually arrested. And in the context of anticipatory bail, the Supreme Court has recently held on compassionate and on human grounds that an accused denied anticipatory bail can in exceptional circumstances can still be given protection from immediate arrest. That is, even if you are denied the pre-arrest bail or the anticipatory bail purely on the basis of humane and compassionate grounds, there can be created an exceptional circumstances through which the person can still be protected from immediate arrest if this person is the sole bread earner of the family. And this is done so as to allow the accused to arrange or make arrangements, financial or otherwise, for the family before surrendering in the trial court. Now this will make up a great example of compassion in the ethics paper. So kindly make note of such examples, given it will be really useful if you quote them in the ethics paper. This will definitely help you get those extra brownie points. Now moving on to the question of the day. Now in front of you is the answer for yesterday's question of the day. Now the answer here is C, 2 and 3 only. Further, this is the question of the day. Kindly attempt this question and provide your answer in the comment box below. With this, we come to end of today's discussion. Thank you.